This video is about how to balance chemical equations. This is something you'll need to be able to do in your first year chemistry courses and any other chemistry courses that you might take after that. You probably learned how to balance equations in high school science, but if you haven't done it in a while, or if you're new to it entirely, this video will hopefully teach you how to approach these problems. So let's start with an example. So in this example, we have ZnS plus ALP reacting to make ZN3P2 plus Al2S3. So the key to balancing equations is to make it so that both sides, the reactant side on the left of the arrow and the product side on the right of the arrow, have the exact same amount of each type of element. So the first thing you should do when balancing an equation is count everything on both sides. So on the left, we have one zinc, one sulfur, one aluminum, and one phosphorus. On the right side, we have three zinc, two phosphorus, two aluminum, and three sulfur. So let's check what's different. All of them are unbalanced. So we have an inconsistent number of zinc, sulfur, and aluminum, and phosphorus. So what we need to do is alter the coefficients that come before the molecular formula. So for example, writing a 2 before ZnP3P2, what we cannot do is change the coefficients. So we're not allowed to say we have three zincs on the right and one on the left. Let's put a 3 underneath the Zn here. We can't do that. But what we can do is we can put a 3 before ZnS. And what that does is it makes it so that we have 3 Zn, 3 Zn, 3 sulfur, 3 sulfur. So now what we can do is update this. So zinc and sulfur are balanced now. So the aluminum and phosphorus are the only things unbalanced. And what you'll notice here is that aluminum and phosphorus both have 2s, and these are in the same molecule. So if we put a 2 before this, we now have 2 aluminum and 2 phosphorus on both sides. So now what we've done is made it so that the left side and the right side are both identical, and that's the end. That is a fully balanced equation for the reaction of ZnS with ALP. So now let's try another example that is a little bit trickier. So what we have here is C3H8 reacting with O2 to make CO2 and H2O. So in the last example, we really could have started with any of the elements first. For example, starting with the aluminum or sulfur instead of the zinc would have been just as easy. So if you go back and try to balance that starting with the other elements, you'll find that you'll probably have a pretty easy time. And while there's no wrong way to approach this problem, we can make it easier on ourselves by choosing to start with certain elements first. So before we decide that though, let's do our count of everything on both sides. That's going to be something that we do first for any balancing problem. So let's see, on the left side, we have 3 carbons, 8 hydrogens, and 2 oxygens. And on the right side, we have 1 carbon, 2 hydrogens, and 3 oxygens. So none of these elements are balanced at this point. So how do we decide where to start? Well, we should really kind of think about this one as where not to start. So what we want to avoid is starting with elements that appear in more than one molecule on each side. So for example, oxygen. So it appears in one molecule on the left in O2, but it appears in two molecules on the right side. So what makes this kind of tricky is if we change one of these coefficients, it affects more than one molecule at a time. So you'll notice if you try to tackle this problem by balancing the oxygen first, you can do it, but it just will require more trial and error than if we were to start with, for example, carbon, which only appears once on the left and once on the right, and hydrogen, which only appears in one molecule on the left and one on the right. So let's start with the carbon and hydrogen instead, because those ones are the ones that are going to be a little bit simpler. So what I'll do first is, let's just start with the carbon. There's three carbons on the left and one on the right. So the way we can change that is by putting a 3 before CO2. So now we have 3 carbons. This has also changed our oxygen count as well. So before we had 3 oxygens on the left side, now we have 3 CO2 molecules, and each CO2 has 2 oxygens in it. So that means we have 3 times 2 in this one molecule, or in these 3 molecules. So that's 6 oxygens here, plus the one that we have in H2O. So right now we currently have 7 oxygens. But before we touch on the oxygen, let's also balance the hydrogen. So we have 8 hydrogens here and 2 over here. So the way that we can fix this is by making this have a coefficient of 4. 4 because there's 2 hydrogens per H2O molecule. So if we have 4 of the molecules, we have 4 times 2, which is 8 hydrogens altogether. Again, we've also changed the oxygen count because there's oxygen in the H2O molecule. So now we have 6 oxygens from CO2, and we also have 4 from H2O. So what that gives us is overall, we have now 10 oxygen particles on the entire right side. So now that carbon and hydrogen are both balanced, now we can tackle the oxygen. And it's actually pretty easy now because the right side has 10 and the left side has 2. And since the left side only has oxygen in one molecule, we just need to change the O2 coefficient so that we have 10 oxygens on the left side. So if we put a 5 here, 5 times 2 is 10. So now we have 10 oxygens on the left, 10 oxygens on the right, and that's it. We're finished balancing. So I really recommend that you get in the habit of checking these as soon as you're finished, because if you happen to check them and you notice that something is off, you automatically know that you haven't balanced it correctly. So it's generally pretty easy to tell if you've made a mistake when you're, for example, on a test or something. So let's try another example. In this one, we have aluminum reacting with HCl to make AlCl3 plus H2. So what we're going to talk about in this one is, well, practice with balancing, but also a common problem that comes up when we have diatomic molecules. So diatomic ones being like H2, N2, O2. So there's often a problem that comes up with these involving fractions, and we're going to tackle that. So once again, though, we are going to start by counting everything on both sides. So the left has 1 aluminum, 1 hydrogen, 1 chlorine. The right has 1 aluminum, 3 chlorine, and 2 hydrogen. So the aluminums are currently balanced. We can just leave that for now. We can kind of tackle the hydrogen or chlorine. It doesn't really matter which one we do first. I tend to like saving hydrogen and oxygen for last. They tend to be a little bit tricky sometimes. So just my instinct is to start with chlorine here. So there's three chlorines on the right and one on the left. So what I'm going to do is say 3-HCl. So now what happens is I have three chlorines on the left and three hydrogens on the left. And so our hydrogens are still unbalanced. So the issue here is we have three hydrogens in HCl because there's three HCl molecules. There are two hydrogens in H2. So since this is an odd number, there's no whole number that we can put before H2 that's going to give us three. That's okay. What we can do is we can use a fraction. So how this is going to work is the number that we're going to put in the numerator is going to be the number of hydrogens we want on the right side. So we want to have three hydrogens on the right. The denominator is going to be the subscript for H2. So it's going to be a 2. And what this does is it essentially breaks this H2 up into just H. So the 2 and the 2 kind of cancel each other. So we end up with three hydrogens overall on this side. So there is a bit of an issue here with this, though, because we're not allowed to have fractions in our overall balanced equation. So you always want everything to have the smallest whole number coefficients. But this is really easy to fix. All we have to do is multiply the entire equation through by the denominator of this fraction. Because if we multiply this by 2, it will just turn into 3. We'll cancel out with the denominator. So we're going to multiply everything by 2. So this will be 2 aluminum. This will become 6-HCl, 2-AlCl3, and then it will just become 3-H2. So now let's just double check our count and make sure this makes sense. So we have 2 aluminums on the left. We have 6 hydrogens on the left and 6 chlorines on the left. On the right, we have 2 aluminums. We have 6 chlorines because we have 2 times 3 is 6. And we have 6 hydrogens because we have 3 times 2. So everything is fully balanced in this one. And you should be able to do this anytime you aren't able to find a whole number multiple to put a coefficient in. And like I said, this comes up the most when you have these diatomic molecules that are, for example, H2, N2, F2, just the same atom twice in one molecule. Okay, so the final example I'm going to do in this video will help you learn to balance equations that have polyatomic ions in them. So polyatomic ions are things like SO4, NO3, CO3, etc. So in this equation, for example, you will notice that there is a group of atoms, NO3, that's in these parentheses here with its own subscript. And on the left side, there is also an NO3. So in your first year chemistry textbook, you will find that there will be a list of all the common polyatomic ions that you need to be familiar with. So you'll want to make sure that you recognize those so that you can tell whether or not you have them in your equations that you're balancing. But even if you're not familiar with that list, in this case, it is a little bit obvious that you have a group of atoms that has its own coefficient rather than just, for example, saying 3N and 9 oxygens. It's the entire group times 3. So we're going to count everything on the left and the right side, but what we're going to do a little bit differently this time is we're going to treat the polyatomic ion like as if it's its own atom. So instead of NO3 being a nitrogen and three oxygens, we're just going to pretend like it's one thing that we're balancing. So how that's going to look is the left side, we have two borons, we have six bromines, one hydrogen, and one NO3. So we're just treating it like it's its own element. And then on the right side, we have one boron, three NO3, because the subscript is three for the entire group. We have one hydrogen, and we have one bromine. So at this point, hydrogens are balanced, but everything else is unbalanced. So the boron, the NO3, and the Br. It doesn't really matter where you start in this case because everything appears just once on each side. So like boron is only in one molecule on the left and one molecule on the right. Same with bromine and same with hydrogen and NO3, really. So it doesn't really matter where we start. I'll just start with boron. Doesn't really matter. If you try doing this example on your own and start somewhere different, you should still end up with the same answer. So if there's two boron on the left and one on the right, we're going to need to put a two coefficient before the BNO3-3. So that gives us now two borons and six NO3 because it's two times three for our NO3. Then on the left side, since our NO3, we now have six of those. What we can do to fix that is we can put a six before the HNO3. And now we have six hydrogens and six NO3s. So the NO3 is balanced. The boron is balanced. It's just the hydrogen and bromine that aren't anymore. So since we have six hydrogens on this side, and six bromines on this side, what we can do is just put a six before the HBr, and now we have six hydrogens and six bromines, both on the right side. And there you have it. That example is now fully balanced. It looked a little bit more complicated at first because of the NO3, but if we tackle it so that the NO3 is its own group instead of balancing the nitrogen and oxygen separately, it ends up actually being pretty easy. So that's it. We've gone over several examples of how to balance chemical equations and how to handle some of the trickier things that can come up. This is something that will just get easier and easier the more you practice it, so be sure to try out some more problems on your own.